right. Hi there, everyone. I'm Alaina, and today I'm going to tell you the linguistic backstory of the regular expression. Regular expressions look pretty intimidating. I mean, imagine being a new coder and seeing this monstrosity. When I started coding, I was pretty freaked out by regular expressions. I just didn't get them. If I were a Shiba Inu, I would look just like this. Some of you might relate to that sentiment. Some of you might wonder how you can get better at writing regular expressions. The usual answer is something like Stack Overflow. But people tend to use Stack Overflow to copy and paste code when they're in a pinch, rather than to learn the proper way to actually write regular expressions. To truly understand regular expressions, I propose an unorthodox route. Learn linguistics. Go, do it right now. No, I mean, I'm being a bit facetious and, you know, this is a big thing, learning linguistics. What I really mean to say is, learn how regular expressions work in the field of linguistics before trying to use them in JavaScript. This is what I'll be walking you through today. Let me take you on a journey that begins with Noam Chomsky, who's pictured right here, and ends, oh, look, a cheer, cool. Chomsky fans in the audience, me too. And this journey will start with Chomsky, and it will end with the regular expression. So, as some of you may know, Chomsky is not a computer scientist by profession. He's a linguistics, a philosopher, a political activist, and a ton of other things. But his contributions to computer science were pretty accidental. His major contribution to the field of computer science is something known as the Chomsky Hierarchy. The Chomsky Hierarchy is an ordering of grammars. But since most of us in the room are not linguists, we'll have to cover what a grammar is before we can go any further. So, first thing, I'll take you through a linguistic crash course so that we can understand Chomsky's hierarchy. So, grammars. Grammars provide the rules that build languages. Some of you might also wonder, what's a language? Well, a language comprises of symbols and the rules to apply to those symbols. In other words, languages comprise of symbols and a grammar. These symbols can be combined to make strings. The grammar provides us with a set of operations that can be used on these strings of symbols. To be a bit more specific, grammars provide a framework with which input or intermediate strings of symbols can be converted into some output string of symbols. Throughout this presentation, I might refer to input and intermediate strings as non-terminals and output strings as terminals. I'm just telling you this now so that if you hear these different terms, you'll know that they mean the same thing. So, I want to make these terms feel a bit more tangible because obviously learning linguistics in 2 minutes is not a thing that anyone can do. So I'm going to provide an example using a made-up language from the world of Harry Potter known as Parseltongue. So in Parseltongue, there are 3 terminal symbols and 3 non-terminal symbols. They're right here. In Parseltongue, there's also a set of rules for converting non-terminal symbols into terminal symbols. So now let's go through an example of converting a non-terminal string into a terminal string. So here is our starting string. It is a non-terminal. Oops, I'm sorry. One slide back. This is our starting string. Now, I'm going to make one conversion of the first non-terminal symbol into a terminal symbol. However, this conversion does not make the entire string a terminal string. The string is still a non-terminal because there are still non-terminal symbols, the words am and snake, in there. So, with that being said, I'm going to make the next conversion. of am into s, the string is still a non-terminal. Finally, however, the string will become a terminal when I turn snake into this ss. So, we just produced a string of entirely Parseltongue terminals, which is otherwise known as a terminal string. Since we used the Parseltongue grammar to create this, you could call this a grammatically correct phrase. Cool. So now that we've learned some new linguistic terms, I'm going to reintroduce you to the Chomsky hierarchy. It looks quite like this. In the interest of time, I'm going to hone in on the regular grammar, which is that innermost circle. So what is so special about this regular grammar? Well, in the process of converting a non-terminal string into a terminal string, regular grammars have no knowledge of the string's past states. Once the regular grammar converts one non-terminal symbol into a terminal symbol, the grammar essentially forgets what the previous state of the string was. We care about regular grammars because they are regular expressions. I mentioned a slide ago that regular grammars retain no information about intermediate steps in converting an input string into an output string. So what does this tell us about the regular expression? The forgetfulness of regular grammars implies that translations in one part of a string do not impact how non-terminals are translated in future steps. This means that there's no coordination between the different parts of the string in creating the output string. This gives us some insight into why programmers first brought regular expressions into code. Because regular expressions convert input string to output string piece by piece, they're wonderful at pattern matching. In programming, regular expressions provide the rules to convert a pattern into the set of strings that match that pattern. So in JavaScript, this is what the match method does. It takes in a pattern, let's say it's called regex, like up here, and this pattern is a regular expression. And then match will find all substrings of a string, which I've called s, and then match, and sorry, it will find all substrings that match that pattern within the string s. So the linguistic origin of this programming concept that we know, regular expressions, is starting to make a bit more sense now. One question remains. How else do regular expressions in programming relate to those that we've seen in linguistics thus far? Well, I'll walk you through their similarities before their paths fork. Regular expressions of linguistics and programming use the same three grammatical operations. These operations are alternation, repetition, and concatenation. I'll talk you through what these three rules look like using both words and then some examples. Alternation effectively gives us this logical OR operation. To understand alternation, I'm going to tell you a great story. It's a true story about the 1920s when a lot of Greeks were emigrating from Greece to the United States. My family was one of those set of Greek people. Given that my forebears didn't speak English, it was up to the immigration officials to determine how their Greek surnames would be spelled using the alphabet that we use in English. So some of my relatives ended up with the surname Kafkes, spelled with E-S. And then others ended up with the last name Kafkes, spelled with I-S. Lest our family reunions turn into something like these cats, which are like way aggressive, don't want that to happen. I can use alternation in order to create a pattern that matches both spellings of my last name, thus pleasing everyone in my family, which is pretty cool. So, now that we've talked about alternation, we're going to move on to repetition. Repetition allows us to match an expression zero or more times. Let's look at some bit strings in order to see repetition in action. All right, so I have this pattern right here, and it is 0, 1 star. What 0, 1 star will match is 0, and then 0 followed by any number of 1s. The star is something known as a meta character, which is basically a shorthand character, and it symbolizes one of the many forms of repetition that you can use in JavaScript. All right, on to concatenation. Concatenation joins expressions together in order to create new patterns. I think that concatenation is pretty useful when we're trying to see how matching different conjugations and tenses of English verbs look. So, we have this regular expression right here. It's call. Call will match many forms of its infinitive to call. So it'll match call, calls, called, calling, all sorts of things. But as soon as we add another letter or another pattern to that regular expression, only calls will be matched. So, yeah. Now that we've talked through these examples of the rules that both engineers and linguists use in terms of regular expressions, it's time to discuss how regular expressions in code, and JavaScript in particular, differ from their linguistic predecessor. Regular expressions in programming languages have two major add-ons. These are back references and quantifiers. Once again, I'll talk you through these differences with some examples along the way. Back references allow regular expressions to store these small patterns or sub-patterns. Back references can be used to match all the laughing messages that you send your friends, and I'll show you how. So, take for example the humble word ha. The pattern above denotes ha as a sub-pattern using those parentheses, and then references it using the backslash one shorthand symbol. This meta character tells us to match for the sub-pattern again. Then, the star at the end matches the second ha, repeated 0 or more times. So to put it a bit more simply, this pattern that I've written here matches the string ha repeated over and over again, one or more times. I mean, you can test it out if you want, but it might just look like this right now, a little bit of forced laughter. But yeah, cool. So, some of you might notice something a bit more disturbing about back references, and it is that they go against the purpose of regular grammars as it's spelled out in linguistics. As a reminder, the purpose of regular grammars is not to retain information about previous states or previous places in the string. So, despite the performance hit that this violation will cause, programmers enjoy having a way to match repeated substrings. On to quantifiers. So, quantifiers alter the greediness of the regular expression matching. What does greediness mean here? Well, levels of greediness are measured by the programmer's answer to the question, how much of that one thing do you want? Let's look at the star, plus sign, and question mark quantifiers for some examples in code. All right, we saw this example a bit earlier when I was discussing repetition. If you'll remember, the pattern 0, 1 star matches 0, and then 0 followed by any number of 1s. The star quantifier matches the expression to which it is applied, which is the 1 here, 0 or more times. So I can contrast this with the plus sign quantifier. The plus sign quantifier matches the expression to which it is applied 1 or more times. So this means that from the previous slide, we had 0 as a possible match, whereas now we do not. And then one more quantifier that's pretty cool to look at is the question mark quantifier. The question mark quantifier matches the expression to which it's applied 0 or 1 times, only those two cases. This means that the pattern that I've written above only matches 0 and 0, 1. The star, plus sign, and question mark quantifiers that I mentioned are just a few of the many quantifiers out there that JavaScript programmers use. Quantifiers are nice because they give programmers more flexibility to fine-tune their regular expressions than the linguistic rules allow for. And now, the sun must set on our linguistic journey through the land of regular expressions, even though the sun in Berlin does not set until 9 p.m. I walked you through the path that regular expressions traveled from Chomsky's theory to JavaScript. I showed you how regular expressions differ in linguistics and code. All that cool information aside, I think that the most important takeaway from this talk is that regular expressions were put into programming languages such as JavaScript for very pragmatic reasons. They were also tweaked for practical reasons. Learning about the linguistics behind regular expressions helps us understand why the people who brought linguistics into code made these very particular design decisions. This goes to show that interdisciplinary learning enhances your programming knowledge. I encourage you to seek out concepts that were brought into computer science, software engineering, or even JavaScript specifically from other disciplines. Trace them to their roots, like I did today, and you can deepen your understanding of those concepts. Thank you, everyone. Once again, I'm Alaina. I work at a cool company called Medium, and I love how linguistics and programming intersect, so feel free to come talk to me about it after this.